Hello, my name is Jose Guzman. I'm one of the HR directors here at Delta Dental, Minnesota. This month, we are celebrating Black History, and we have a very special guest today with us, Chief Brian Tyner from the Minneapolis Fire Department. Chief, thank you for taking the time to meet with us today. It's a privilege to have you on. Why don't we start with introducing yourself?
Well, thank you. First of all, thanks for having me. I'm very excited to do this. My name is Brian Tyner. I am the fire chief of the Minneapolis Fire Department. I've been with the Minneapolis Fire Department for about 27 years now. Started back in 1995. Didn't have any idea I'd end up being the fire chief at that time, but here I am, and I've been the chief for about a little over a year now, and very excited about it and happy to serve my community. So that's me in a nutshell. Certainly didn't grow up thinking I wanted to be a firefighter. I hadn't seen any black firefighters as a, as a kid, as in during my youth, and so I didn't really even look at it as really a possible career choice. Growing up, there was a lot of things I wanted to do. Of course, I wanted to be an athlete. That didn't work out so well. So I entered college. I went to the University of Minnesota, and I was thinking about entering a career in business. Kind of partied my way out of the university after a few years. Jumped around in a different bunch of different jobs. Banking. Ended up in the transportation industry, and first driving buses, and then working in the office for a bus company. And then I left there to be a trucker, and my plan was to start a trucking company with my dad. But at the time when I was working at the bus company, there were a couple of firefighters there that were working there kind of as a side job when they weren't here at the fire department. And they told me about this opportunity, and it's something I really got interested in. The fire department, I don't know if you know this, but they only take applications once every 2 years. So, of course, I had just missed the application period. So I had 2 years to kind of think about it and prepare for it. I made the decision it was something I wanted to do. I spent over a year preparing to apply and take all the tests and do everything necessary to become a firefighter. And very fortunate for me, it worked out for me. And now that I'm doing it, or have been doing it, I really couldn't imagine myself doing anything else. Some of my proudest moments, that you think about some fires and some rescues and things like that. That I've been a part of, and certainly I'm very proud of those. Proud to be, recognized in my community. I grew up in North Minneapolis, so I was able to serve the community that I actually grew up in. But as I got later on in my career, some of the things I was able to accomplish that I'm very proud of is one, I created a commercial building registration program when I was the fire marshal for the city. That kind of revolutionized how we approach building commercial building inspections. First, we didn't have a cyclical approach, and we only did complaint-based inspections. So now we're able to do them on a cyclical basis and make sure all the buildings are safer before they get really out of compliance. I think a second one was the implementation of the EMS Pathways program. It's an award-winning program in which we recruit and bring on minorities and underserved populations to learn emergency medical technician and get certified in EMT, and eventually come on to the fire department or to EMT organizations, Hennepin County, hired as a paramedic, possibly a dispatcher, and provide career opportunities to people that may not have considered these careers as career opportunities. So I served as the president of the Minneapolis African American Professional Firefighters Association for 7 years. At that time, I was the longest serving president. Now our current president, who was my vice president at the time, is the longest serving president. But some of the things that we had to take on then were inconsistencies, or really inequities, I should say, that we were experiencing here on the fire service. I don't know if you know this, but the Minneapolis Fire Department, they hired black people on the fire department back in the early 1900s, and had them on for a little while, and then they stopped. And then it wasn't until a court case in which the city was required to hire minority firefighters in the 70s. And the first class came on in 1972 that, you know, black firefighters were once again hired onto the Minneapolis Fire Department. But as you can imagine, you know, that change was met with a lot of resistance and there were a lot of struggles along the way. So 20 years later, when I came on in 1995, it certainly wasn't as bad as it was back in 1972, but it probably wasn't where it needed to be. So taking on some of those inequities and also helping, you know, people to prepare themselves for higher ranks and higher achievements. The first black captains weren't, you know, made until, I mean, other than back in the early 1900s, the first black captains weren't promoted until, I think, around 1993, 1994. So they were pretty new, you know, when I came on in 1995. I ended up becoming the president in 2001. We still didn't have a lot of black captains then. So helping people to prepare for those promotional tests and things like that was another issue that I ended up putting a lot of energy in when I was the president of the Minneapolis African American Professional Firefighters Association.
In which you see some of the fruits of your labor kind of show now.
Yeah, today. Absolutely. Absolutely. And it's something I continue to do. I'm actually working on a leadership development program as we speak to do that same thing for the entire department. Yeah, you know, I just remember, you know, it was like almost total chaos. I mean, we as the fire department hadn't dealt with anything like that probably since the 67 riots. And so none of us that were currently firefighters had ever dealt with anything like that. We did have standard operating procedures and things in place in case something like that were to happen, but we really hadn't the need or the chance to exercise them. One of the challenges that we met is that all of those procedures were based upon us moving out as teams, but with the security component provided by either the police or possibly the National Guard. And for the first day and a half, or almost 2 days of those riots, we didn't have that component. And so we met with a lot of resistance and had a lot of trouble getting to emergency scenes. I mean, to the point where we had to just stop trying to go because we were getting trapped in scenes. We were having, you know, things thrown at us, vehicles damaged. We were very fortunate in that we didn't have anybody sustain any serious injuries, but it was a very dangerous and chaotic scene.
Yeah, I can only imagine. Despite those challenges that you mentioned, what are you most proud of from that, from the aftermath of George Floyd's murder?
Well, I think the thing I'm most proud of is that, you know, we were able to persevere. We were able to get in there, get the fires out. We actually only had one fire fatality throughout that whole thing, with all the buildings that burned down, with all the, you know, mayhem that was happening. We actually only had the one single fire fatality. So I think that was very fortunate. I do think we got, we were fortunate in that the protesters and people that were setting buildings on fire were concentrating on commercial buildings. And they weren't setting on fire residential buildings. So I think that also helped a lot with avoiding loss of life. but really, I'm proud of the way that the department showed up and, you know, represented itself and represented the city, even through the resistance and things that were happening. I actually had firefighters that were upset that they had to, you know, hold back and not, you know, run into those areas, even though it was too dangerous for them to do so. They still wanted to get in and help. And so we actually had to hold people back, you know, until we were able to get the National Guard and the police to be able to help us get in and out of those scenes. And, you know, guys just wanted to help, you know, and they wanted to make things better. You know, Black History Month means quite a bit to me. I'm actually part of the Black History Month committee here with the city. We partner with Hennepin County to put on a Black History Month program every year. We just kicked it off last week. To me, it's a time to reflect, a time to celebrate our history and our heritage, and a time to learn about our history and heritage. And so while it's something we should be doing all year round, you know, February is set aside to really concentrate on that. And so I enjoy that time every year. I I still learn new things about Black history. And really, Black history is American history because it's really intertwined in the fabric of the history of America. So when you think about it that way, you know, I think it's important that everybody learn about Black history and the contributions that Black people have made and the struggles that Black people have had to persevere. So, but yeah, it's an exciting time for me. When I was young, I remember for Black History Month, we would, not only learn about Black history, but we'd learn about the Underground Railroad and things like that. And for Black History Month and more often during Juneteenth and in June, we'd get to reenact the Underground Railroad and, you know, they'd set up this deal where we'd run from house to house and hide and things like that. So for me, it was a good experience and I always enjoyed learning about that and I always enjoy teaching people about it when I have the chance.
Well, clearly you're a role model for the Black community, not just the Black community, but for everybody. And we appreciate the service that you are in to protect the city and residents. And we're very grateful for what you do and what your department does. So once again, I just want to say thank you for taking the time to meet with us today. It's a privilege to have the conversation with you. And hopefully we can chat again soon.
Absolutely. Thank you. Thanks again for having me.
You're welcome.